Welcome. This video is a step-by-step hands-on tutorial to show how you can fit my new Overblow-Booster Mk2 parts kit to a standard out-of-the-box harmonica and just transform it into an amazing overbending machine. Okay, in this video I'm going to show you how to take these raw loose parts here and use them to transform a standard Hohner crossover or special 20 into a crossover and special 20 with the overblow booster attached. So let's make a start. I'm going to use the crossover as the bass harp. It's actually easier to fit the parts to the crossover. The special 20's got a couple of extra steps and it's a little bit more tricky. So I'll use the crossover as the basic harp. But then, as appropriate, I'll just show the extra steps on the special 20. But the main procedure is the same. So the first thing to do is just disassemble your harp, which should be pretty basic for everyone. Remove the cover plates initially. If you've never disassembled a harmonica, I'd suggest do not take this job on because, you need to have at least a basic understanding of how to use a screwdriver and a drill and a few things like that. So if you don't, then please don't take on this job because you're just going to end up disappointed. So anyway, put your screws in one of the cover plates just to keep them safe. And then here are the reed plate screws. Now, unfortunately, we have to just get rid of the Hohner reed plate screws and replace them because they are a little bit too big, too long and too tall for my overblow booster parts. I've got a couple of screwdrivers here. Each one's got a magnetic head on it. This is a slightly bigger one. This is a slightly smaller one. Okay, so the first step is to replace your reed plate screws with these ones that are supplied in the parts kit. Now, these have got a small head on them and they're slightly shorter. They're 9mm long. For those who want to pay a bit more attention to things, at this point it's a good idea to flat sand the base of your draw reed plate. In this case, I'm just going to put it together without doing that, but that's a good step. And also, if you want to do any embossing or whatever to your reeds, this is a good time to do it before you start assembling the overblow booster parts. It is possible to do that kind of thing with the parts attached, but it's more tricky. So as you can see, I'm putting these three screws in there. I'm just going to tighten them up sort of loosely. A good idea when you're tightening your screws is just to let the harmonica sit down on a surface. It could just be a piece of wood, some kind of flat surface. And then just tighten your screws finger tight. And then look along the front of the harmonica and make sure that everything's nice and parallel. Some people might want to recess their reed plate slightly back from the comb. I mean, there is a tiny bit of wriggle room on this harp. Obviously, on the special 20, it won't be an issue. But with the special 20, there is another step you need to take. Again, with the special 20, if you want to flat sand the draw reed plate, now's a good time to do it. Okay, with the special 20, here's your comb. Now we're going to have to remove these tabs here. So what you need is a sharp knife, and then you just basically run the knife along the comb like that. Just a couple of times, and then you can just use your finger pressure to push the tab and it'll break. Do the same for the other side. So this, just running the sharp knife just creates a weak point at the base of the tab. And then you can clean up the tab in there like that. Okay, at this stage I'm going to show you how to drill the holes for attaching the screws for the rear push bar. That's these little screws here. So it's a little bit different for the crossover and the Special 20. Crossover, you can attach the reed plates immediately. With the Special 20, it's best to do the drilling with the reed plates off so you can see what you're doing. Now, to drill the guide holes for these screws, I'm just going to use a standard, battery hand drill, because I'm sure that all of you will have one of these at home. Those of you who've got an upright drill press with different speeds, you can use that instead. But frankly, the hand drill will work just as well. And in some ways, it could be better for the Special 20 because you can actually see what's going on. So in order to know where to drill on the comb, I supply this little screw guide thing with the parts kit. It's just a piece of acrylic with a couple of holes. Now, at this point, you're going to need something like some sort of scriber. This is what I use. You just need something with a, you can buy them, on Amazon, this kind of thing. Just something with a sharp point that'll go through these small holes. So what you need to do is you need to get the screw guide and you need to place it on the back of the comb so that the one edge is against the, pretty much butting against the edge there. I mean, within half a millimeter, it doesn't really matter too much. And then you need to press quite hard to the center of each guide hole without moving the part. And then at the rear of the comb, you need to hold the guide part with this part sort of pretty much flush against the top and put a little mark on the rear of the comb. Now on the Special 20, it's pretty important to do that on the side with the small holes, on the treble side. Don't make the mistake of doing it on the bass side because that'll just mark your comb and you'll have to go back and do it again. So just, pay attention to that. It's got to be on the treble side. On the crossover, Marine Band Deluxe or whatever, you can just use the same guide part. Hold it so it's sitting central on the comb and flush against the end. And then use your scriber just to make a couple of guide holes there. And again, one on the end. And if the guide holes are not precisely in the middle of the comb, just move them slightly to so that they look like they're nice and central. Okay, then get your drill. Now I've got a 1.2 millimeter drill bit. I mean, if you're in America, you're not going to have to translate that into thousandths of an inch, I guess, but you should be able to get a 1.2 millimeter drill bit. On the crossover, the wood is so soft you can pretty much tap the screws straight into those guide holes. But just for the sake of doing things properly, I'm just going to drill in there a little bit. These are just guide holes to get the screws started, because the screws will tap into those into the wood quite nicely. And then at the base of the comb here, I'm doing the same thing. Okay, so that's the Marine Band the crossover comb. Now the Special 20 is trickier. Basically, what the problem with the Special 20 is that the comb is not solid. There's just a kind of a central partition point there, and it's easy to go one side or other of that. So it's quite important to make sure your guide holes are pretty central. Mine look pretty good. So what I'm going to do is start my drilling and just drill very carefully. And I'm going to be looking down as the drill comes through. And then I'm going to be guiding the drill one way or the other to try and make it central on that central partition in the comb. So this is where the Special 20 is a trickier beast than the Marine Band. So I'm just looking. I don't know how easy it is to see the drill bit coming through, but you should just see the plastic sort of. You shouldn't see the complete drill bit if you can, and it shouldn't be going on the other side. So it's really a matter of just doing it slowly by eye as it comes through, and then guide the. Oop, see, that's come too much to my side. So I'm going to go back and try and guide it back the other way. It's not really, life or death, this kind of thing, because the screws will. So that's actually come through too much on my side, but it'll still work. So don't get too hung up on that, because the screw will still hold in just with the outside thickness of the comb. And I'm just putting a tiny little guide hole in there. So just make sure your drill bit's not bigger than 1.2 millimeters, because if it's too big, the tiny screw here won't tap in. So it should be 1.2 millimeters, or maybe 1.1 millimeter would be fine. So that's all the drilling done. So now with the special 20, I'm just going to put the reed plates on now. As I say, with the marine, with the crossover, you can do that beforehand. In fact, you should do it beforehand, because this screw guide is about the same width as the crossover comb with the reed plates on. And it's also the same width as the special 20 lip comb. So it's easier to kind of hold the guide central with the crossover once you've got the reed plates on. But with the special 20, do the drilling with the reed plates off for the reasons that I've explained. Put all the so the special 20's got 8 screws. And so you just want to put these in. Now these screws, they are M1.6 screws, which is the same as Honer uses, but they might be not exactly the same thickness. I mean, they're made by a different manufacturer, and so you get slight variation. So I think these screws might have a slightly narrower diameter than the Honer ones. So don't overdo the pressure when you tighten them up. Just do them finger tight, because you could strip them out if you go too crazy. Okay, so just finger tight, and they will grip nicely. It's always good with when you're tightening up harmonica screws to start at the middle and go out, because it just spreads the pressure on the reed plates. So they're all attached now. So we've now got both harmonicas in the same state there. Okay, now it's time to start attending to these raw cut parts, the two sliders and the two base plates. So let's start with the base plate. So as they come raw off the laser cutting machine, they've got all these extra bits here, which you're going to have to just press out. Okay, so it's very, very simple. Press them out, get rid of them, and just pay special attention to the magnet holes, and just make sure there's no extra bits left flopping about there or lying around. So you should get quite a nice clean part. So that's very simple and easy to do. This is the opposite side, and that's the adhesive side. So there's one done there. Here's the treble base plate. So these are ones for the crossover, but exactly the same thing happens for the special 20. So what we'll do now is get these little magnets. These are 2x1 millimeter magnets, and they need to be inserted in all these magnet holes. So you can see on the base plate there are some large holes, and those are for the reed plate screws. But then there's a bunch of other evenly sized, 2 millimeter holes, and they are for the magnets. I've carefully sized them so that they will hold a magnet. So all you need to do is just grab your magnets in one hand in a stack, push it into the hole, and the hole is the right size so it'll actually grip the magnet, and you can just lift the stack off. This won't happen every single time, but it should happen most times. The main thing is don't allow two magnets to be held in the magnet hole. The magnet stack's getting quite low now. I'm just going to switch to a piece of metal here just to hold the magnets in place. It's just easier to grip them, and I'm just going to put them into the treble base plate. So you can see it's quite simple. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Seven magnets in the draw base plate. So you should get at least 16 magnets, maybe one or two over, just for in case you lose one. Now, at this stage, it's really important to get the magnets below the level of this adhesive layer here, which is hard to do just with the initial press fit. So you need to get something like this. Is a this is an M2 bolt, and I'm just going to put it on each magnet and just give it a very light tap. You don't want to overdo this. You don't want the magnet to go all the way through, but you just want it to go a tiny way into the material, so it's below the level of the adhesive tape. So don't overdo this. Just enough to get it below the level of the tape. So I hope you can see that now, that the magnets are slightly below the level of the outside layer of adhesive tape, and I'll explain why that's a good idea shortly. So this is a little bit time consuming. This is why you pay extra for the finished parts, because this kind of thing, you know, it's not rocket science, but it's just time consuming. So don't overdo this. You don't want them to go all the way through. You just want them to go into the material. So at this point, I haven't found any better way than this slightly laborious method, but it's pretty important. Okay, if you look on the rear side now, you should see the magnets nearly all the way through, but not all the way through. Okay, the next thing we're going to work on is just finishing off the tidying up the sliders and attaching the guide screws to them. So now the sliders are going to come with two different surfaces. The lower surface, where they rub along the base plate, will be pretty smooth, but the upper surface will vary. Most of them should look quite good, but they could have some discoloration. So we'll get rid of as much of that as we can, but just it's important to recognize that the top surface is not the important surface in terms of how it operates. The bottom surface is what matters. So I'm just going to use a little sponge sander like this. And normally I go to my workbench, but I've just got a little flat surface here. And for the purposes of showing you what's going on. So I'm going to start on the clean surface. Now, it might seem that the surface is nice and clean and you don't need to sand it, but sanding will help smooth off the round off the sharp edges of the slots there, so that the thing smooths, runs, slides quite nicely. And then try and clean up the outside surface. Now, no matter what you do, there's going to be some discoloration still on the outside surface. But please don't worry about that. It's not actually going to affect the operation of the slider. In fact, the lower surface sliding sanding is probably the most important. Just to smooth off the edges of these slots. Now, at this stage, you're going to need a specialist tool, and that's a tap. It's an M1.6 tap, because we're going to be putting these tiny little screws here into the sliders, and they are 1.6 millimeter M1.6 screws. So you need a 1.6 millimeter tap just to provide a thread in the sliders so that the screws will screw into the sliders themselves. Well, you can tap from either side, really, but I suggest tapping from the side that you're going to be putting the screw in. On the blow plate slider, I'm going to be coming in on these two holes here. Now, what I normally do is just to kind of guide the tap in, I just lubricate the tap slightly by putting it in my mouth. And the holes are, they are sized so that the tap will just go in quite easily. You can buy these taps on, you know, quite cheaply on Amazon. You can get kind of a kit of them. And the same thing on the draw slider. Just needs a few strokes just to get the screw started. As soon as the tap grips, you can pretty much withdraw it. Now, those of you who've got one of these buffing machines, at this point I would go to the rear part of the slider, the part that's going to be sliding along the base plate, and just tidy up these holes there. That's not critical. I've done, you know, made heaps of these things without actually doing that, but that's, you know, it's a useful extra little step to take. You might find that if you tap from the rear side, you'll get a less of a protrusion. So you could experiment with that. Maybe do one hole from one side, one the other way, and see what works best for you. Now, the next step just involves a bit of humble super glue. What I normally do is just get a piece of masking tape like that, and then just put a puddle of super glue on the masking tape. This is just so that you can get rid of it later. So what you could do first now is grab your little spring and attach this spring to the rear push bar like that. So just basically dip the spring into the puddle of super glue like that, and then pop it onto the push bar. It should just stay, should just sit in there pretty vertically, and just put that away to one side so that the glue can dry. So this is just basic household super glue, nothing fancy about it. Now the next step's quite fiddly, so pay attention. So I'm getting my screwdriver here, and this has got a magnetic head. This is pretty important to make this life easier for yourself here. So basically just get one of these tiny little flathead screws. So there's four of them there. And now find something non-metallic to dip into the super glue. So what I'm doing is just dipping a toothpick into the super glue. Non-metallic, so it won't attract with magnetic attraction. Then I'm wetting my finger, picking up one of these little washers, which acts as a spacer. And then I'm going back to the super glue and putting a tiny dab on the bottom of that. And then I'm getting one of my sliders. I'm making sure that I've got the right surface. So we want to go to the slightly discoloured surface. So in this case, I'll start on this one here with that rounded end there. I'm going to a little patch on my workbench where I've got a depression in the workbench. And now I'm just screwing that little guide screw in. So I'm going to do that again now. Tiny bit of super glue. The washer. Unfortunately, I had to go through this process because I couldn't find any screws short enough that on their own. So I had to add the little washer as a spacer to make sure that the screws don't... If you don't tap the holes with that 1.6mm tap, the screws won't go in properly. So just leave that to dry, and now I'm going to the blow slider and doing the same thing. So this is, you know, a bit laborious, but it's not, you know, it's not difficult. Just requires a bit of patience and attention. It might seem a little bit of overkill to add the super glue twice, but I just want to make sure that these things stick down and stay there for years and years of hard playing, so that's why I'm going to all this trouble. Now you can see that the magnetic head of the screwdriver really makes life a lot easier here. This would be so difficult if your screwdriver isn't magnetic. So if you're going to do this job, I recommend you get hold of a magnetic screwdriver. So I'm just wetting my finger, picking up the washer like that, putting it on the screw, and then going back and dabbing a tiny bit more super glue on the shaft of the screw. And then finally coming back, again going to this little hole on my old desk here, screwing that in. Don't over tighten, just finger tighten. And the combination of the thread plus the super glue will give you a really nice sturdy little guide that's projecting below the surface of the slider. And these are really important because they're going to be moving in those little slots in the base plate. So that's the difference between the raw parts and the finished parts. These are the finished parts. So the sliders have been sanded and they've got these four guide screws already inserted, screwed into them and firmly attached. The rear push bar has got the spring attached and the base plates have been cleaned up and they've got all the magnets sitting firmly in them. So this is the finished part kit, as opposed to the raw parts kit that we started with. So in my opinion, the raw parts are not difficult to finish off, but if you want to pay double, you can get the raw parts finished off to this point here, ready for attachment to the harmonica. Now this is a brand new Hohner crossover, so the reed plates are really clean and pristine. Now I know that many of you will be buying my parts kit to attach to an existing harmonica, one of yours, so it's likely that your reed plates are not going to be pristine and clean. They would have been sitting under the covers for quite a while and, you know, accumulated debris and stuff over the years. So it's important to clean up the reed plates, and there's an easy way to do that. So what you can do is simply get some kind of gaffer tape like this, and on the blow reed plate, it's very simple. You just basically put it on the plate, smooth it down and lift it off, and that'll clean off dust and debris. On the draw reed plate, you've got to be a bit more careful because obviously the draw reeds are sitting there. It's only these top four draw reeds that you need to worry about. So you can stick like that. Now when you pull the tape off, make sure you pull off that way, okay, towards the front of the comb. Don't pull off this way or else you're going to lift the reeds up and bend them. So if you do that, it's not my fault. I've told you what to do. So be very careful about that. So, you know, this will clean off your reed plate and pull it off that way, okay? Okay, so we've got the reed plate cleaned off now, and that should work for even an old, well-used harp. If you want to, you can disassemble your harmonica and put the reed plates in a, ultrasonic cleaner and go to all that trouble, but this tape trick should be fine for our purposes. Okay, now we're finally getting to the point where things start getting assembled. So here's the base plate for the blow slider. So the first thing to do is just get a sharp blade and remove this backing strip from the adhesive tape. Okay, so just get it in one corner and make sure that you're not lifting off the adhesive tape itself. It shouldn't be a problem. It should come off in one go. Sometimes it comes off in a few goes like that. Now this part is really critical. Don't press down hard to start with. Just lay the base plate on your harp, and now carefully look at the base plate. Just, you can attach it very lightly. Now the main thing is it should be parallel with the back of the reed plate there, and all of these slots should be fairly equidistant around the reed slot. So these slots are slightly wider than the reed slots, but you don't want the base plate off to one side or another. So just give it a good old look. It's good to shine some extra light on it and look down carefully. And when you're satisfied that everything looks well centered and the reeds are not going to be, you know, hitting the slot when you're hitting the base plate. You can just give it some finger pressure like that. Press down like that. And then we'll do the draw base plate as well. Now the adhesive tape that I've chosen is fabric reinforced and very sticky. So it's really strong adhesive tape. And you can see the reason for getting those magnets down below the level of the outer surface. It's just so the magnets don't stop you pressing the adhesion right down onto the reed plate. Okay, now this is even more critical at this point because you're putting the base plate above reeds that have got to vibrate actually in those slots. So look, again, I'm putting it on really lightly. And now I'm looking down carefully at all the slots and the reeds. Normally when I work on harmonicas, I use a little magnifying headset. It just magnifies things a couple of, you know, times, but it really makes quite a difference, in my opinion. Some people don't like to use them, but yeah, I use them all the time. You've got on the crossover, you've just got one screw that sits there. So that's your guide screw. And once you're satisfied that all the reeds are free and that the base plate is sitting carefully above them, you can then give it some finger pressure like that. Now on the special 20, you've got three screws there. So that's actually kind of helpful, really, because it helps you guide things even more precisely. So again, lift off the rear, and then place your base plate very carefully down onto the reed plate again, without pressing down. Now here you've got 1, 2, 3 reed plate screws that will slot into these carefully positioned holes in the base plate, and they will help guide the thing in position. But still, before you put any pressure on it, just look down and make sure that all your reeds are really going to be able to swing free in that within the confines of that base plate. Okay, so basically that should be parallel with the front, this should be parallel with the back. Just, if you need to, just jiggle it slightly. That's looking good. So now I'm going to put a bit of pressure down on that. So both of them are the same, the crossover and the Special 20, but the Special 20's got two extra screws there. Okay, the next step is to just make sure that the base plates are really firmly attached by rubbing them on a smooth surface. I normally go to another workbench that I've got, but just to make it easier to see on this video, I've just got a smooth piece of, this is actually kitchen workbench kind of material. And so now what you want to do is just basically rub your harmonica gently against that smooth surface, just to make sure that the adhesion of the base plate is really, really good. So I'll do that on the blow side, and now on the draw side as well. You don't have to rub large amounts of rubbing. If you've got a stable workbench, you could use both hands. And basically just, a few millimeters each way. It's just to basically make sure that everything's really nice and firmly stuck down. That is easier to do on a stable workbench with two hands holding the harmonica. Anyway, you get the idea. Okay, next step is to remove the protective masking tape on the outside, like that. This should come off in one piece, but it might not. Now there's a few little bits of extra bits here from the laser cutting which are got stuck there, so I'm getting rid of them. And now we're able to see the magnets quite clearly. So what I'm going to do now is just press the magnets down so that you can hear them. They need to be below the surface of the of this outer layer. This is actually Teflon tape, so that's what allows the smooth sliding of the sliders. So I'm just pressing the magnets down first, and then I'm going to be removing this protective masking tape. The masking tape is just there when the laser cutting is done. You get a lot of fiery burn marks, and the masking tape just means that you're going to end up with a nice clean Teflon surface. So I'm just pressing all the magnets down So they sit below the level of the Teflon. This is really important because you don't want your sliders rubbing against the actual magnets themselves. That will just add more friction and scratch the sliders. So that's really important. So all my magnets are now, you know, a fraction of a millimeter below the surface of the outer Teflon. And now I'm just going to rub the Teflon again on that smooth surface on both sides. This is after the magnets have been pressed down. Same goes for the special 20, exactly the same procedure. Again, I'm just going to make sure my magnets are pressed down to the reed plate. You can sort of, they make a satisfying clunk when they hit the reed plate itself, and you can see that they're all below the surface. And then again, you do the same sort of thing here. You rub the plate. Now, it's important that you get a really smooth surface because you don't want to be damaging that Teflon surface. So make sure it's really smooth. Otherwise, it could damage the Teflon base plate surface. I'm just getting rid of some tiny extra bits of tape that have been left behind. So it's important that you don't have anything that's going to impede the sliding properties of the slider. And you can see my screws are just slightly below the surface of the base plate as well. That's whereas the honer screws would have been sticking out, you'd have to shorten them. So that's why I supply the special screws for the harmonicas. Okay, things are really moving along now. Now you can see that these little guide screws in the slider are going to slot into these little slots there. So you can actually get the slider in there now and just check it's working fine. And same with the draw slider. The magnets hold it down on the base plate and ensure it's really nice and airtight and doesn't fall off the harmonica. And the Teflon allows it to slide really nicely. Okay, everything's looking pretty good there. So we'll get rid of those. Now we're going to attach the rear spring bar with these extra screws going into these guide holes that we've made in the comb. It's not a bad idea at this point. Just get a drill bit and take off any roughness from the screw, from the drilling we did before. Okay, now the first of these three little screws to insert is the tiniest one. That's this little baby one here. This is an M1.4x3 screw, and that's just going to help you your spring stay in place and centered on the comb. So you just put that in the rear hole of the comb and just guide it in. It doesn't add too much pressure so it strips, but just it just needs to sit there like that. So then we get our rear push bar with the spring already attached and firmly held in with the super glue, which is dried now. And get the spring and just make sure it just sits over that little guide screw on the right rear of the comb there. And then hold it in place with your fingers like that. And then get one of these screws. Again, these are magnetic, so they're going to sit nicely on your screwdriver. And just hold the spring bar so you can actually see the screw hole there. Start with the base one. And just insert it into the screw hole. And don't go too far at this point. And then get the other screw. And just move the push bar along slightly so you can see the hole in the comb there to guide your screw into. And again, just push that in a few strokes. Now, the important thing here is that the push bar is snug against the comb, but isn't so snug that it's restricted. So if I put a bit of pressure on, you can see the push bar is not now moving evenly. So I'm going to start with that screw, and I'm going to release the pressure until the push bar moves easily to both its positions. And then I'm going to go to the rear screw and find the optimum position for that one as well. So I've put too much pressure on it. I can't even move the push bar now. So I'm just going to relieve the pressure slightly. And the main thing is that the push bar can go to each position without any obstruction, because it's really important that you know, is free moving. It's better to err on it being slightly loose than tight. Okay, so make sure that that's running really easily, and it can go to, you know, each position without any obstruction. That's really important. Now the next bit is super simple. You just get your slider, which has already got the guides in screw guides in it, and you simply place it on the base plate, and these little lugs will fit over the pins or the location parts on the slider, and suddenly you've got a slider perfectly positioned on the base plate and moving over it. And this is going to now close off your blow reeds. Okay, because we put everything down really nicely and carefully, the positioning, the registration is really good. So we're going to do the same now with the draw slider. And again, that will just drop into place quite easily. And you won't have to worry about anything, basically. So you can see the same thing is going on there. You've got open slots with the slider out, and then you push the slider and the slots close. And this is going to help your overdraws. So if I do a draw 7 and then push the slider, you can hear it just stops the reed altogether. Say number 8, number 9, number 10. Okay, so all our reeds are working as normal when the sliders are out. Slider in, can't play a thing. So the draw reeds will not sound at all with the slider in, and the blow reeds won't sound at all in holes 1 to 6 with the slider in. So that's telling us that these sliders are doing their job, and they're going to start giving us fantastic overblows and overdraws. And the same thing goes for the Special 20. So you can see on the Special 20 there's more reed plate screws, but they're all snug under the base plate there. And then if I put the slider on, it should just locate in place. Now it's important to note that the Special 20 sliders and base plates will not fit on the Marine Band Deluxe or the Crossover, and vice versa. They're totally different designs. You can see the slider is slightly bigger on the Special 20. So, you know, you can't just swap them around between models. They're particular to each design. But the actual operation is identical, and the fitting process is pretty much the same as well. So now we just got to put the covers on. Now with the Special 20, if you want to, you can flatten the backs of the covers at this point, if that's what your preference is. I'm just going to put some standard covers on here. So this is the draw cover. So that obviously goes on the draw side. And then here's your blow cover. And then you just get your cover plate screws and, you know, so that's the Special 20. I've carefully sized all the parts so that the sliders run well, nicely within the covers without without making any noise and touching them. And then with the Crossover, we can do the same thing. Now the Crossover has obviously got a few more cover plate screws. 4 instead of 2. A little bit more laborious assembling the Crossover. Don't tighten up your cover plate screws until they're all loosely in there. And then when you're satisfied on the Crossover Marine Band Deluxe, it's important that the cover plates sit in the grooves, front grooves in the reed plates. So just make sure that that's all looking good. When you're satisfied with that, just put your finger on the base of the cover plate screw and just, you know, finger tighten. Doesn't have to be over tightened. Okay, so we now got two stock harmonicas with amazing overbending potential. As you can see, the actual process of attaching the parts is pretty simple, but please pay careful attention to everything that I explain along the way, because with harmonicas, the devil is in the detail. So if you followed all my steps correctly, this is what you should get when you play your harp. Basically, as you press, just on the bottom 6 holes, as you blow, and then push the button there, the note should just cut out straight away. And same for the top 4 draw notes. So basically that indicates that the slider is totally cutting off the air, and that means you're going to get lovely overblows and overdraws. So starting with the overdraws on 10, number 9, number 8, number 7. You can add vibrato to them. Now the overblows, 6. Five, four, three, and number two, and number one. Well, I hope you enjoy your harp. It should sound like a totally new instrument now with the overblow booster parts fitted. When you come to do your overbends, overblows and overdraws, they should just sound come in so much more easily and be so much more controllable, be so much more pure, louder, and expressive. You can add vibrato to them and all sorts of stuff. So, have fun.